Good morning, everybody. To Marcia, I only have one thing to say. Who dat? Who dat? All right. I want to say a special thanks to Diane Vanderhey, who I just saw outside, and there she is in the back, your executive director, and to Jim McDaniel, your wonderful president. Thanks for having me here this morning. I got my coffee because I stayed up a little late last night to watch, no, not a basketball game, but the other compelling TV last night, and it was such an extraordinary moment. I was really touched when the president said that we have proved that this nation can still do big things. And then I thought about coming here as I was driving over this morning. I thought about all of you and the larger group of folks who work on water issues and realize that you, of all people, know what big things are about. You have been and continue to be part of the big thing of dealing with water pollution in our country, taking our country in 40 short years, maybe a little longer, but 40 short years of the Clean Water Act, to water quality that's vastly improved, to tackling a seemingly insurmountable problem with nowhere near the resources you need to get it done. And so I know I'm gonna talk a little bit about vision and challenges, but I wanted to start off on a morning as historic as this one is for me personally, with thanking each and every one of you for the hard work that you've done and continue to do to protect human health and public safety through your work. So congratulations to each and every one of you. And I want to thank you for allowing me to be here. I was listening to Marcia's wonderful introduction, and it really is time for us to have a conversation about where we're going with this water program. And water quality really is something I'm passionate about. I feel this is a friendly audience, so I can admit that. I studied water quality and treatment as a chemical engineer at Tulane. That was my thesis topic. When I went to graduate school, analytical methods to look at ion treatment using resins was part of my thesis. So somehow, besides the fact that I grew up in a world-class city located in the crescent of the Mississippi River near Lake Pontchartrain, water continued to follow me throughout my academic career as well. Now, throughout my career at EPA and at the state level in New Jersey, I've been involved in water issues, but usually now it's about contamination and how that can affect communities and people's lives. I've seen how far we've come. I know how far we have to go. Ladies and gentlemen, when Congress wrote and passed the Safe Drinking Water Act 35 years ago, they were responding to conditions that would be intolerable today. Cities and towns lack facilities to adequately treat contaminated water. 85 to 90% of water systems had little or no information on what bacteria or chemicals might be in the water they delivered. In almost four decades, we've reached a much better place. In the vast majority of communities, we've met the goals for safe water that were set in the 1970s. But yes, we still face daunting challenges. While we've cut the flow of many conventional pollutants into our tap water sources, we now face challenges from other pollutants from less conventional sources. Not the visible oil slicks and industrial waste of the past, but the invisible pollutants that have only recently been available for us to see thanks to advanced science. There are a range of chemicals that have become more prevalent in our products and in our water, our bodies, in the last 50 years. And those many thousands of chemicals are the great unfinished business of the 1974 Act. We also face together serious issues of deferred maintenance in our infrastructure. I know that each and every one of you are doing just about everything you can with systems that are overworked and under budgeted. Many urban communities are struggling to modernize their systems. Rural communities are struggling to meet safe drinking water standards at all. In places like California and Arizona and Texas, we see the demand for clean water increasing while supplies are tapering off, or in some cases disappearing due to droughts. This is where we are. Our system is deeply stressed. Our financial and our natural resources are limited, and our needs are not negotiable. So what do we do? I believe that the answer for us lies in innovation. Innovation in the ways we approach drinking water management and regulation, and innovation in the technologies that we employ to get there. Now, forgive the pun, but innovation is nothing new in your field. It has always played a part in advancing our environmental protection and our economic growth. Now, today we use things like catalytic converters to cut harmful vehicle emissions. We replaced ozone-depleting CFCs with innovations that are cleaner and less expensive. In your world, we've seen systems adopt things like ultrafiltration and ozonation. These and other advances are ensuring that we meet drinking water standards, safety standards, even while we add new users and new communities to the system. But the fact is that if we're really going to make more progress, we're going to have to make our drinking water systems work harder in the years ahead. That means we're going to have to start working smarter today. Today I want to talk about how we harness our nation's unmatched capacity for invention and innovation to improve drinking water protection. I'm proud to share with you for the first time a vision, my vision, for providing clean, safe drinking water. It's an approach that works within existing law and capitalizes on the idea of new innovations. The plan does not require more regulation. It uses our existing regulations more efficiently and more effectively. Our vision is a way forward that facilitates greater collaboration between government and communities and industry, one that provides cleaner flowing water through a faster flow of information, and one that accelerates innovation across the board. That innovation will promote new jobs and help us develop new technologies to meet the demands of rural and urban and other water-stressed communities. My idea is really built around four key components. First, rather than working one by one, EPA plans to address water contaminants in groups. Second, we will engage innovators, entrepreneurs, and small businesses to improve drinking water technology as we look at new contaminants. Third, we want to leverage all appropriate authorities, such as pesticide laws and chemical laws, to confront and preempt, to prevent drinking water contamination. And fourth, we want to work closely with you and all our other state and local partners on up-to-date information sharing, monitoring analysis, and development of these ideas. Let me take a minute to go through the 4 points in a bit more detail. On grouping of contaminants, so far, I feel as though we've done a pretty good job of looking at unregulated contaminants. We can identify them. That's part of the news. But we are identifying new contaminants in drinking water at a much faster rate than we are able to address them satisfactorily. So the American people are confused and worried. And you feel more and more pressed to try to deal with contaminants that, frankly, you don't even have the science or the ability to regulate. And EPA stands with you and understands how you must feel. What slows us down is a process that looks at each individual contaminant one at a time. With more than 80,000 chemicals identified in the Toxic Substances Control Act inventory, and science providing new information every single day, we're simply not keeping pace with increasing knowledge we have about chemicals in our products, our environment, and our bodies. This is actually something Congress foresaw in the Safe Drinking Water Act, that the vast numbers of chemicals in use would grow and that many would find their way into drinking water supplies. They saw that EPA couldn't regulate them all individually. And so, ambitious group-wide rules would be vital to manage threats to water safety. In talking with you today, I want to begin a conversation, two ways, about how we address groups of contaminants. We'll work with you and others in the drinking water community to determine how we define these groups, what technologies are best suited to addressing certain groups, and how we can use grouping to make our systems faster and more effective. How to stay in front of that ever-increasing number of chemicals we learn about every day. On the second point, engaging the private sector. Advances in drinking water technology make our treatment and monitoring systems more reliable, more sustainable, more cost-effective. They can also help us plan and implement for the long term so that newly identified threats and new technologies don't mean piling another component onto an already complex treatment train. EPA has some of the best water scientists and engineers working in our labs, but that's not enough. That's actually not nearly enough. We have to build on that solid foundation, but we have to engage the private sector, innovators who will develop the next generations of drinking water technology. So I'm interested in collaborating with universities and technology developers and other stakeholders to accelerate the development and adoption and commercialization of treatment technologies that will mean cleaner water at a cheaper price. We want to set up a series of demonstration projects to test and refine innovations. These projects will bring together utilities and states, technology vendors, and researchers to test products, develop cost and operating data, and optimize monitoring of potential health risks. They'll also give us a chance to tackle specific challenges like the issues facing smaller systems in rural areas. There's an economic consideration here as well, because this is an opportunity to foster the kinds of innovations that will save money for local ratepayers and local governments and create jobs in the process. It'll put our inventors in the global market for technologies that developing nations will need. Developing nations with limited water supplies that will need to grow their economies will turn to the United States, to our scientists, to our inventors, to our companies for the technology to do it. It positions us in the U.S. to lead the way in innovations we will need to adapt to climate change. Supporting technology incubators, competitions, fellowships, and grant programs geared towards communities, universities, and small businesses, we can protect our environment and public health and spur economic opportunities. On leveraging all appropriate authorities, we want to take common sense steps that make the most of EPA's broad-reaching programs. That means effectively using our pesticides and industrial chemical authorities to protect drinking water. I know many of you feel that frustration, that you're at the end. You're the receiver of contamination that would be best off prevented from entering the drinking water supply. Rather than having EPA's programs work in silos, water and pesticides and chemicals, we should work together to achieve a common end. With FIFRA, the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide, and Rodenticide Act, we can use pesticide registration to assess drinking water risk, generate missing data, and develop analytical methods for drinking water. Under TSCA, the Toxic Substances Control Act, we can use EPA's chemical action plans to identify and address drinking water issues posed by widely used chemicals. This means we can stop contaminants before they get into drinking water, a safer and cheaper alternative than trying to get them out of drinking water. Finally, on the last and most important point, working with state and local partners, we want to collaborate with you and your colleagues to improve information exchange and ideas. When the rules for public water systems monitoring data were written, data literally came to EPA on paper in boxes, Advances in IT technology, in information technology, open wide the possibilities for EPA and states to exchange critical information. That will let us do more with the data that we have without burdening you with additional information collection requirements. We want to share the powerful tools to better target program oversight, compliance assistance, and enforcement to areas of highest risk. And we want to make the work that we do interactive and more transparent. New communications tools can enable states, industry, and most importantly, consumers to learn more about their drinking water. We envision a system where people will have better access to timely information about the water flowing into their homes. Those are the broad goals of a new drinking water strategy: efficiently addressing water contaminants in groups, engaging innovators and entrepreneurs on new technology, leveraging the authorities we have to address drinking water contaminants, and working closely with you on improved monitoring, analysis, and information access. We welcome your ideas on every single one of these concepts. We've developed this strategy by looking at the issues we're facing and playing to our strengths. That means fostering innovation. It means finding win-win solutions for our health, our environment, and our economy, and it means broad collaboration. I believe we have what we need to make that happen. We're not reinventing the wheel. We're not changing the laws. We've tried to think about being in your shoes and make the changes in our program, on our side of the ledger, that would actually strengthen our partnership and improve our service to the American people. Now we'll need to hear from you. As the vision takes shape, I encourage you to be part of the conversation. Make it better. Fix it. Tell me why I'm wrong. Tell me why I'm right. I like that even better. You're going to play an essential role in turning these ideas into reality. If they work, you'll help us move forward into a new era of cleaner drinking water and environmental protection. Now, before I close, I just want to acknowledge all the EPA staff who may be in the room, some of whom I probably don't know yet, but one in particular, and that's Cynthia Dougherty, who runs our drinking water program and who has helped me think through these issues by adding real-world experience and knowledge of what you do to my concept. I admit, mine is more of a vision, because I'm an engineer, and I think we can solve all problems through technology. But it's been Cynthia. Another engineer? No, look at that. another woman who has managed to take these ideas and help me think about them. I wish you a wonderful conference. I wish you lots of great discussions. You have a tremendous agenda. Thanks so much for having me here.